Our scripture is found, as John read, in John chapter 13, verses 35. And it says, "By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if you," what? "If you love one another." You know, I looked it up here, and in the Bible commentary, the word love here is agapo. The command reads literally, "keep on loving." You know, sometimes we just think loving is just a one-time thing, but the commandment is to keep on loving. Have love literally means keep on having love, constant, fervent manifestation of love rather than isolated, fitful outburst or charitableness are the evidence of discipleship. So it's saying that we shouldn't just be going on a mission trip once every 2 years to fulfill a, quote, love quest. Our mission field should be everywhere all the time. I was able to meet Brother Gonzo in here, and that's an example of you being in a mission field all the time, Brother Philip. We are to preach God's love wherever we're at all the time. "Whither thou goest thou," Peter bypasses comment on the new commandment. Perhaps its requirements were too rigid for his present level of experience. He was, however, interested in Jesus' reference to departure, the nature of which he misunderstood, as had the Pharisees earlier. Now, I want to talk to you guys about two types of Christians. Turn with me to Luke chapter 18. So the agape love, the constant love, the unconditional love, the charge that we are called to do continually is something that the rich young ruler thought that he was doing. And if you know the story in Luke chapter 18, the rich young ruler in verse 18 says, "And a certain ruler asked him, saying, Good master, what shall I do to inherit good eternal life?" How many of us here want eternal life? Everybody does, right? How many of us, that's the only thing that we want? You know, sometimes we think that that's it. Heaven, eternal life. Did you know going to heaven is not gold? The goal shouldn't be the gold roads and the big mansions that are set up. The goal of heaven is being next to Jesus, being able to spend and see him face to face. You see, Jesus answered him in verse 19. It says, "Why callest thou me good? None is good save one, that is God." 20, "Thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother." And he said, "All things I have kept from my youth." So the rich young ruler responds by saying, "I've done that all since I was a kid." Verse 22 says, "Now when Jesus heard these things, he said unto him, Yet lackest thou how many things?" Did you know that's the biblical proof that one coveted, cherished sin can keep you out of heaven? Can keep you from your relationship with Christ? I don't want to sound too harsh, but that's the story here. Jesus said, not 15 things you lack. He said, one thing you lack. One thing you lack. He says, sell everything that you have, distribute it to the poor, and come follow me. And what happened to the rich young ruler? He went away sad. And you notice that he doesn't even have a name. He failed the test. Christ Object Lessons, page 392, says, "The lover of self is a transgressor of the law." This Jesus desired to reveal to the rich young ruler, and he gave him a test that would make manifest the selfishness of his heart. He showed him the plague spot in his character. the young man desired no further enlightenment. He had cherished an idol in the soul. The world was his God. In his love of self and worldly gain, he was put on harmony with the principles, out of harmony with the principles of heaven. Now there's a contrasting story. We see somebody who has a theoretical knowledge of God, just like the Pharisees, as we just read. He had a theoretical knowledge of God, but he did not know God. You turn to chapter 19 now. Turn with me to Luke chapter 19. And it's the story of Zacchaeus. Now we always learn in the children's growing up in church, the story of the wee little man, the story of Zacchaeus, right? And chapter 19, verse 1 says, "And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief amongst the publicans, and he was rich." You know what a publican was? What was a publican? Tax collector. Were they liked by the Jewish nation, or were they disliked? They were hated, right? Now look at the motive of what Zacchaeus was there to see. Was he there asking about how to get eternal life? Was he there asking how to get more riches? No. Verse 3 says very simply, "And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press because he was little of stature." Friends, if you take anything away from today's message, my prayer is for us all individually to seek to see Jesus for who he is. Jesus is the gospel. Jesus is the good news. A lot of times we here want to complicate things. Or maybe sometimes talk about the things that we have to give up to be a Christian. But the gospel so much isn't about what we give up, it's what he gave up. And in response to that love, you know, the scripture reading was John 13:35, but there's an important one written on your wall right over here. John 13:34. "Love one another as I have loved you." Now, it says to love one another. What does in the context of love one another mean? Is that just your family members? Is that just the people who are nice to you? You know, Jesus said to love your enemies, right? As Oscar, my brother, always says, he didn't say to tolerate them. He says to love them. Love them as what? As I have loved you. How did Jesus love us? As my little daughter Megan says, I love you this much. And Jesus, that's what he said when he was on the cross. Amen? You know, this morning, in thinking about this sermon, I had a lot of struggle with it all week. And usually sometimes when you're going to come and speak, instantly something comes to your head. But for some reason, all week I struggled. And it was a struggle all the way up even till this morning, you can ask my wife, as I got up at 6:30. And I was asking God, you know, I don't want to preach a sermon to get praise from anybody. I don't want to preach a sermon to make somebody feel good. I want to preach your words so that we may be changed. So that we may leave this place better than the way that we came in and have true revival. So then I thought of these verses, Psalms 119, 107. So how do we have revival? How do we have revival? What does the word revive mean? What does it mean to revive somebody? It meant they were dead, and we're bringing them back to life. Psalms 19:107 says, "Revive me, O Lord." The King James Version says, "Quicken me," but that's another word for "revive me, O Lord." Revive me according to thy word. So if you want to be brought back to life, what's our first step? Read the word of God. Then the second step, if you have your Bibles out, I want you to underline that because that's the first step. And write one next to it. The first step is through the word. The second step, turn with me to John chapter 17, verse 17. And in the King James Version, it reads, "Sanctify them by thy truth, thy word is thy truth." So how do we know what truth is? The word of God. So we want to be revived, we've got to read. You want to know what the truth is? You got to read. The third step, underline that, then put a little mark on there, and then put John 15, verse 3. Here's the beautiful part. And this is the sanctuary service, my friends. The sanctuary service is all within these three verses. The third part is, now ye are what? Clean through what? The word, which I have spoken to you. So if you know the sanctuary service, first you have the court, right? That's where the sacrifice happens. That's the justification stage. That's where we're made just as if we never sinned. Amen? That's the justification stage. Then you step into the holy place, right? What's the holy place represent? The second part, what we read, John 17, 17. Sanctification stage, right? We have to be sanctified. What does sanctification mean? Does it mean just showing up to church for an hour on Sabbath and doing a little check mark and saying, yep, I got my weekly goody-goody in. Now I can clock out, boop, go back to my, country radio or B104 or 107.9, and I can go back to watching the normal things that I normally wouldn't watch on Sabbath, but on Monday it's okay. It's Monday to watch these things, that's okay. And Tuesday it's okay too. Because it's not the Sabbath, you know, I can watch all these other things on every other day. See, sanctification is a process. There's three steps to it. There's three pieces of furniture in that holy place. What are those three pieces of furniture? Table of Showbread represents Word of God. What's the second part? The altar of incense, right? What does that represent? Prayer. I'm giving you the steps to sanctification, right? Read the word. The second part is prayer, right? Prayer is us talking to God, and God speaks through us through what? The word. It's pretty simple. Simple, but it's hard. The last piece of furniture is the lampstand, right? I used to think it was candles, actually. I really thought it was candles, but it's actually a lampstand with oil in it. And the oil represents the Holy Spirit, right? And when you think about that, what does the lampstand represent? Us, okay? The light? Thank you, Pastor Duncan. It means for us to testify. To testify and show people what God has done through us, through the Holy Spirit, not through Andrew Yu, not through my brother Oscar, not through Pastor Duncan, not through John Amore, not through my wife, but what God has done through us, through the Holy Spirit. Now here's the better question. Can you hear a light? He could have used a trumpet, right? To signify testifying. But he uses a lampstand. Why? Because you can only see a light. We are called to be the lampstands out there wherever we go. So we aren't only supposed to be in this church and say, hey, brother, happy Sabbath, good to see you, And I've done it. You can ask my wife. We've had the masks of the Sabbath masks on many times. But God wants you to be the same here as you are in your home, as you are in your workplace, as you are in school, as you are in the local restaurants. Wherever it is that you are, be, you are to be a light testifying of Christ. Sermon's over. No, I'm just kidding. Jesus says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. Desire of Ages, page 676 says, the union with Christ once formed must be maintained. Christ said, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye except ye abide in me. There, this is no casual touch, no off and on connection. Did you hear that? It's not a casual touch, off and on connection. It's not something that we just come on prayer meeting on Wednesday and say, boop, let me clock in. All right, God, you got that? Ministering angels, recording angels, all getting it. You got this? I'm here. I opened up my book Wednesday. Vesper service, boop, did it. Saturday, showed up for an hour, boop. You got that? Love is what? Constant, right? It should be a constant thing no matter where we go. Even the guy that cuts you off on the street. Even the guy that cuts in front of you in a line after you've been waiting there for 15 minutes. Even the guy that you know is probably going to spend the money on alcohol standing at the street where you have your windows rolled up and you're looking at your phone acting like you're doing something. I say that because I've done it. But the love's supposed to be constant. You know, if you read early writings, and there's a chapter that says, go teach all nations, Sister White is very, very explicit in showing what God thinks of the people who walk by a soul that you could have helped. She compares it in the writing of a baby being stuck in the snow with no clothes on, and you walking by, and you could have helped that baby, warmed it up, picked it up, and taken it home with you, but you just walked by. If you were that baby's mother or father, how would you feel? She says. She says, wildly indignant, right? She uses those words, wildly indignant. And then she goes on to say, that's how God feels when we pass somebody by that we could have helped. She says, angels marvel at a mere surface gratitude of the way that we come back and we present our offerings. You know, Philip, you gave a wonderful lesson this morning about spiritual sacrifices. You know, did you know the Bible says that when we bring our best in Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6, you know what that's compared to? When we bring what we think is our best to God, it's compared to filthy rags. And if you look at the original term, it's actually the rags of the women when they have menstrual cycles. That's exactly what it's compared to. She says, when we bring our best, that's what happens. I'm so glad that it's not dependent on me. Amen? And I'm so glad that it's not dependent on the things that I have to bring. If you read the consecration chapter of Steps to Christ, it's chapter 5. She tells us specifically what we have to do. And it's the only thing we can do. She says, many are wondering, how can I make a total surrender to God? And the only thing that we are able to do to cooperate with the Holy Spirit is to surrender our will. It's one of the hardest things that we can do. But let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. Have you ever been asked by God to do something you didn't want to do? Have you? Have you felt guilty about it because you didn't want to do it? Amen. You know, our Jesus in Gethsemane was faced with a task that his humanity didn't want to do. And he asked his Father how many times to take that cup from him. Every time you're put in that situation, our job is just to give him our will. Because we're not going to want to do it. Naturally, our hearts are enmity against God. That means we war against him. But the only thing that we can do is give him our will. Brother and sister, mark that down. Consecration chapter of Steps to Christ. And I love how that's titled because it's not a leap to Christ. Sometimes we think when we come to Christ, we've got to go from this to the last part of glorification. So we have justification in the sanctuary. We have sanctification. And then what's the most holy place represent? Glorification. That's what we're all looking forward to, amen? For God to come and glorify us. For him to come and take us back. There's no casual touch, no off and on connection. The branch becomes a part of the living vine. The communication of life, strength, and fruitfulness from the root to the branches is unobstructed and constant. Let me read that again. The communication of life, strength, and fruitfulness from the root to the branches is unobstructive. Separated from the vine, the branch cannot live. No more, said Jesus, can you live apart from me. The life you have received from me can be preserved only by continual communion. Without me, you cannot overcome one sin or resist one temptation. Now, sometimes people get to that wording, overcoming sin, and they think it's an impossibility. Have you heard Christians say that? Say, you can never be perfect. That's true. You can't. You can't. But the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you can make you perfect. You know, Jesus relied heavily on prayer. And he took our which nature? Are you sure? Some say sinful. Sister White says not to touch this subject, so I'm not going to touch it, but it is. The way that I read everything that says about is Jesus took our humanity in our sinful nature. That's why we can take him all of our struggles. He understands and he knows and he goes through everything that we've already held. John 1 verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Do you know how beautiful that is? That this Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So truth, we speak the truth. We sometimes advocate it, but we sometimes forget that Jesus was full of grace and truth. John 3 verse 30 says, he must increase and I must decrease. Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus as the author and finisher of our faith, for who the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. So my question to you, brothers and sisters, is Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, who was that joy that was set before Christ that led him to endure it? Who was that joy? That joy was you. I want everybody to turn to each other. Ephesians 2, verse 10 says, you are God's workmanship. You are God's workmanship. Turn to each other, look at each other, and say, God doesn't make junk. God doesn't make junk. You are God's workmanship. You guys know what these books were called at one time? What color is this book? You know what the Adventist people were known for in the old days? The people of the... Right? How many of you guys have Bibles today? Amen. I know there's a lot of people that use the devices and things like that, but... And that's okay, you know, when you don't have them. But brothers and sisters, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. These were once called the Red Books. And as an Adventist, you know what the Red Books were. This is the Desire of Ages. Unfortunately, these have become the unread books. You want to know about the life of Christ? This is my brother Oscar's favorite book, Desire of Ages. In fact, he gave it to me inscribed with my name on it. And he'll tell you, when he first started coming to my office and we started working, he would quote Sister White to me and I would say, I read the Bible. You remember that, Oscar? He still makes fun of me to this day. But you know what? The truth is, I hardly read it. But after reading this, it makes me want to read the Bible more. See, that's why Sister White says, I am the little light that leads you to the bigger light. You read Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, all those chapters there, and then you read Patriarchs and Prophets, and you're just like, what? It's just like an open thing. That joy, brothers and sisters, turn with me to Luke chapter 15, verse 7. That joy that was set before you, before Christ, it tells you right here. You looked at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. It says that the joy that was set before you, that helped him endure the cross, we're going to find out what that joy is. That joy, according to Luke chapter 15, verse 7, I want everybody to read it with me. I say unto you that likewise, what? Joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth. More than over the 99 just persons which need no repentance. Guys, Gethsemane. If you read the chapter of Gethsemane, you know Christ could have died in Gethsemane. You read that chapter. He had his hands dug into the ground because he felt the Father slipping away from him. He had blood pouring down his pores. He was completely distraught, bearing the sins of past, present, and future. You guys have done anything guilty before? Something bad in your life? It felt horrible, I'm sure, right? At that time. Imagine David killing Uriah to cover up an adultery. How much guilt did he feel? Psalms 51, that's when he writes, create in me a clean heart, O Lord, and take not thy spirit from me. Gethsemane. Jesus, according to Spirit of Prophecy, would have died in Gethsemane But God the Father sends, she says, the one that took Lucifer's place. The highest angel from heaven. And she says he came down. Coming down from, you talk about these superheroes, they got nothing on Gabriel. You know, if you read the crucifixion chapter, it says the weakest angel in heaven could have knocked the whole throng out as Jesus was being crucified. The weakest angel in all of heaven's angels' army, the weakest one could have knocked everyone dead. But that angel comes down, Gabriel. He gets to Christ and he picks him up. And she's very detailed in it. She picks him up. Jesus' head is in his bosom. And the angel Gabriel isn't encouraging him not to drink the cup. What does he do? He's grabbing the cup and he's encouraging Jesus to drink it. And then the heavens open up, right? And what does he see? Who are the two guys that are up in heaven? Moses and Elijah. You know, if Jesus would have failed, they would have had to come back down. Jesus looking up and Gabriel saying, look, look, drink it. Drink it. All these people are going to come to heaven with you. And at that point, he drank it. He drank that cup. Did he want to? No. If he did, he would have just been like, give it to me. He asked, if there's any other way, Father, let me do this. Nevertheless is the word that was one of the highlighted words of this week's lesson. What does that word mean, nevertheless? It means it's not what I want. Whatever happened before, it's not what I want. But your will be done. The consecration chapter of Steps of Christ says the only thing that we can give him is our will and our choice. You know, to share it, how much time do I have, guys? About 5-10 more minutes? There's like 15 pages here. I'm barely on 3. But I won't keep you too long. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. You can't share something you don't have. Let me say that again. You can't share love if you don't love and know who the author of love is. You can't go out there and say, you know what? Oscar told this story to us again, keep using him. But we were having worship one morning and he talked about a story of Gandhi. And he told this story of this mother who came and her son was eating too many M&Ms as the children's story was happening, right? Too much sugar is what she said, right? So she says, Gandhi, please tell my son to stop eating M&Ms. Gandhi turns to him and says, okay, come back in 2 weeks. And she said, what? Why 2 weeks? Just come back in 2 weeks. So the mother waits 2 weeks, goes home. And 2 weeks later, faithful, she said, all right, today's the day. He said 2 weeks, come back. You're going to stop eating sugar one way or another. Grabs him and brings him in front of Gandhi. And Gandhi says, all right, stop eating sugar. Go home. The mom's like, what? Why? Why didn't you tell her that 2 weeks ago? You know what he said? Because I had to stop eating M&Ms. I had to stop eating the sugar first before I can tell somebody else to stop eating it. You know, Jesus said the same thing, right? What did he say? Before you look at the speck in your brother's eye, remove the plank in your own. Comes back down to that. John 13:34. Love one another as I have loved you. The next verse says, and by this you will know that they are my disciples. What Bible verse tells us the character of God? What Bible verse comes to mind? If someone were to tell you, where in the Bible does it show who God is? What book would you take them to? Would you take them to Matthew, Mark, Luke? Which book would you tell them if you said, I want to know about Jesus? What book? John. Why John? John was the beloved of Christ. But in the beginning, John was known as what? Sons of Thunder. Him and James, right? They had a bunch of zeal. They were going out there kicking butt, taking names. They had a bunch of zeal. They were known as the Sons of Thunder. But in contrasting Peter and John, Peter was the same way in the beginning, right? He was self-righteous at times. He was always the first to speak up. He was the first to say, they'll all betray you, they'll all deny you. Not me, Lord. Not me. They might, but not me. Even if I have to go to prison, even if I have to die, not me. What happened? When we look at ourselves, we will always fail and we will deny Christ. But John's love, John the beloved, out of all the disciples that were there, was the only one that followed Christ all the way to the cross. You know why? Because he loved Jesus. He loved him. He truly, truly loved him. That's a big contrast between Peter and John. Somebody mentioned this morning in the Sabbath school lesson, I don't know who it was. I think it was Oscar, actually. The reproving gaze that Christ gave Peter, if you read the Spirit of Prophecy in the Trial of Christ chapter, that reproving gaze broke Peter. As he denied him, Christ looked at him. He could see Peter denying him. Even with cursing and swearing, he denied him. And as Christ looked at him, that look pierced Peter's heart. And it said, it converted him. At that moment, when he denied Christ, and he saw that reproving gaze that Christ gave him, that look, it wasn't a look of, I told you, look at you. You failure. You know who does that? Satan does. So if Satan's doing that all the time, why do we do it with each other? Who is the accuser of the brethren? Our jobs, brothers and sisters, not just here in this church, as soon as we walk out of there, is to lift people up. That's the only way people will know that you are a follower of God. If you've got to tell somebody you're a Seventh-day Adventist or a Christian, something's wrong. They should be walking up to you and saying, are you a Christian? You've got to be one of the Christians. There's something different about you. As I opened my sermon, I said, here, we sometimes think we have to love God first. But according to Scripture, 1 John 4:10 said, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. How foolish it is then for us to go around studying how much we love God and measuring it, whether it's a teacup or a medicine dropper. It's not much, is it? When all the while God is calling us to behold the ocean, the great ocean of His love, and it is a great ocean, friends, a very big ocean of His love. Acts of the Apostles, page 333 says, in contemplation of Christ, we linger on the shore of a love that is measureless. We linger on a shore that is measureless. Sometimes we think God's love's going to run out. Testimonies for the Church, volume 5, page 740 says, all the paternal love which has come down from generation to generation through the channel of the human hearts does not compare to the love that Christ has for us. How many mothers do we have here? Raise your hands, mothers, loud and proud. You know, Spirit of Prophecy says next to God in Adventist Home, next to God, there was a young mother that dedicated this morning. Next to God, the highest influence for good on human souls, on your children, is guess who? The mother. It's God, mother, angels, father. Did you know that? Even above angels, the mother's influence is the most influential for good to their children. That's why I'm a mama's boy. As my wife calls me all the time. All the paternal love which has come down from generation to generation through the channels of human hearts, all the springs of tenderness which have opened in the souls of men are but as a tiny rill to the boundless ocean when compared with the infinite, exhaustless love of God. Isn't that wonderful, friends? I think we need to meditate on that a little more. Yeah, let's meditate on that a little more. How big's the ocean? Do you know? Huh? So she says it's a tiny rill compared to the ocean. All the love of the mothers and fathers that have passed down through generation to generation since the beginning, all combined, that love all combined. Mothers, you know how much you love your kids. But all that love combined is but a tiny rill compared to the love that Christ has for you. Now, how do you want to treat somebody that Christ loves like that? Do you want to treat them with contempt? Do you want to treat them with revenge? Do you want to treat them with, I'm going to pay them back? No, that's a precious soul of God. You get in a boat and sail for days and days and days, but you see nothing but water and you say, it's bigger than that, even that. The best captains in the world have sailed all the oceans out there, but they haven't even seen a tenth of a percent of it. It's bigger than that. Men wonder whether God will forgive them one more time. Oh, friends, what a meager, paltry idea in God's love. And I'm going to close with this final thought. Our text was, by this all men will know that ye are my disciples, if ye love one another. Matthew 18, 21 through 22. And with this in Luke 17, get both texts so we can look at them together, talks about forgiveness. Matthew 18, 21 says, then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? Do you know why he said till seven times? I did some research. Because the Pharisees thought that if they did three or four times, they were being gracious. So the norm was 3 to 4 times. That was the norm. Peter thought he was being extra gracious by saying seven times. He was trying to make himself look good in front of Jesus. Say, if this guy sins against me seven times, how many times should I forgive him, Jesus? Seven times? And then he's floored by what Jesus said. And we all know, in verse 22, he says, I say unto thee, until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Verse 22. How many is that? 490? I suppose Peter took that away and thought over it a while. He probably kept still for a while after that. You notice there's no record of Peter saying anything after Jesus said that. He was just... He was speechless. But now I'm going to give you one that in some ways is harder than that one. The idea was don't keep record of those offenses. 490 times may seem a lot, but nobody's going to keep records of 490 times. Have you ever forgiven somebody that sinned against you more than 490 times? Here, don't ask my wife. She'll probably say yes to me. I've exceeded that number by seven times, probably, easily. Turn with me to Luke chapter 17, verse 3 to 4, as we have our closing thought. Luke 17, verse 3 through 4. And when you get there, please say amen. It says, take heed to yourselves. If thy brother trespass against thee, rebuke him. And if he repent, forgive him. And if he trespass thee seven times in a lifetime? In a day. Put your mind around that. Seven times in a day, and seven times in a day turn again to thee, saying, I repent. Thou shalt forgive him. In one day, the same man seven times. Can you do that? We can't. But Christ living in us can. Amen? That's what it says. Just imagine Brother Philip and I are talking together and I lose my temper. Then pretty soon I come over to you and I say, Brother Philip, I sure am sorry. I did the wrong thing. I'm sorry, brother. Forgive me. Thank you. But an hour later, we're still working. And I do the same exact same thing. But pretty soon I come around again and ask him to forgive me for the exact same thing that I just asked for forgiveness for just a couple of minutes ago. And he says, forgive you. But suppose a third time before dinner. Jesus says that if that man does this, how many times? Seven times in what? In a day. That Peter is to do what? Forgive him. Or John or James or whoever they're supposed to forgive. Oh, my friends. Why am I studying this with you guys? If God expects that much love and that much forgiveness of a poor little pint-sized heart down here in the world, how are you going to measure the love and forgiveness of the one whose love is like a mighty ocean? Do you see what I'm getting at? If God expects you to forgive unto 70 times, and if necessary, 70 times 7, the same man in the same day, do you think that God would expect himself to be at least as forgiving as that? Don't walk away here today, brothers, thinking that your sins are going to keep you from God. The very fact that you're still here is testimony what God can do in your lives. How could I disappoint a love like that? How could I grieve a heart like that? How could I go on beating and breaking the one whose love never tires, never is exhausted? And I'll close with this story. There's a story of a man named Alejandro Bullón. I don't know if you've heard of him. Have you guys heard of him? Okay. I don't know. I don't speak Spanish, but I've heard this story many times. So if I say it a little bit wrong, and if you've heard it, forgive me, but this is what I recollect of it. He had a roommate in college, and it said that that roommate was very ugly. I mean, he was uglier than me. And that's hard. And then this college roommate, he was studying to be, I believe he was studying to be a pastor also. And one day I'd like to meet this man. I want to see how truly ugly he is. But the story goes that he fell in love as he was on campus. Like that. Love one another as I have loved you. He had that kind of a love for this girl. And she happened to be one of the prettiest girls on campus. And everybody kind of made fun of him, right? Everybody made fun and said, man, even the roommate was like, what are you doing? There's no way. You know, she's A level and you're like double Z level. There's no way that match is going to happen. What's wrong with you? But he just kept going. And he tried. And pretty soon, his roommate started seeing how she was treating him. And then so now he started getting upset. Pastor Bullón started getting upset by saying, hey, at least say hello to him. At least say hi to him. At least be nice to him. He's trying his best. You don't have to go out with him, but at least be polite to him. Now, Bullón's getting kind of upset now because he sees the way that she's treating him. Then one day, the semester passes, and it's time to pay their tuition. And the girl that he liked was standing in front of him paying the tuition, and she didn't have enough money to pay to continue with the school. So she had to leave. But right after that, he walked up, and he had his tuition money, and he ended up paying it. He paid her tuition. And he left the school. Time went by, and you know, this girl was just kind of living her life, not even knowing. And one day, Pastor Bullón walked up to him and said, do you even know why you're still here? Do you even know why? Because you remember that guy that you treated so badly? He said he gave up his tuition so that you could be here in school. She was floored. She had no idea. And one day, she goes back and they meet up. They meet back up again. And she starts wanting to hang out with him. She wants to mingle with him. She mingled with him and she got to know him. And then Pastor Bullón started getting upset again. Now she's saying, hey, don't play with his heart. You don't have to be doing this. You don't have to be doing all this other stuff. Don't be a fake. And she says, no. I'm enjoying his company. Then Pastor Bruno says, but why? What are you doing? He's so ugly and you're pretty and it doesn't even make sense that you guys are together. What's going on? Pretty soon they start dating. They become boyfriend and girlfriend on campus, right? Now everybody's like, what? There's no way. It's kind of like how me and my wife people talk. You know, they're like, how did he get her? You know, something like that. And next thing you know, they're engaged to be married. And then they get married. And Pastor Bullón asked the question, what made you fall in love with him? And does anybody know what the response was? Who's heard this story? What was it? He paid my tuition?
Nah.
Nah. That wasn't it. She said, how can I not love somebody who loves me that much? How can we not love Christ who loves us that much? We in ourselves don't have the love. We love him because he first loved us in our sinful state. I have my little girl Megan. When she was a baby, I loved her with all my heart. It wasn't contingent on her loving me back because she couldn't do anything for me. She was a baby. But I loved her with all my heart. If I had died, she probably would have forgot about me. She probably would have never known anything about me or done anything with me. It wouldn't have mattered to her. But we love Christ the same way that we love our... Christ loves us the same way we love our kids, but even more. Remember the takeaway from this morning. When we leave here today, leave a little better than the way that you came in. And when you go across the people that you are challenged to be around, remember God said, love your enemies. He didn't just say tolerate them. He said to love them. And he said to love them as I have loved you. It's a hard challenge, brothers and sisters, but all things are possible through Christ who strengthens me.